My name is Munish Gupta. I'm on the Managing Committee of the Foreign Correspondents Club. May I, in the interest of time, begin the program by thanking His Excellency, first, the Vice President of India, for making time to be the chief guest and to ring in this ceremonial year for us, the 60th year. I would now request Mr. S. Venkaiah Naidu, the President of the Foreign Correspondents Club, to welcome the chief guest.
Good evening. Honorable Vice President of India, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu, colleagues on the dais, friends, ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome to you to this function, which is going to launch the year-long celebrations of the 60th anniversary of the founding of the Foreign Correspondents Club of South Asia. It began in 1958 in a modest fashion. Now we have 825 members. Our members cover the whole South Asian region. So a lot of them are traveling. Some are in Sri Lanka, some are in Pakistan, some are in other parts of the world. But they're all watching this on Facebook because it's going on Facebook Live. We thank you very much, Venkaiah Naidu Garu, for accepting our invitation and gracing this event. As I said, this is the beginning of a year-long program. We have a huge agenda on our to-do things. Some of the things which we are going to do in the coming year, we are going to introduce an FCC awards for the best reportage out of India and the subcontinent by the global media, print, television, radio, and magazines. We are going to have monthly workshops to upgrade the skills of journalists, you know, how to use a mobile phone to do a report a story, and you know, how to use the social media to reach out people and so on. That is going to be a monthly affair. We are also hoping to have workshops and invite senior journalists and editors to talk to young people. And we are hoping to organize a conference of editors from all the South Asian regions, because the club's name is Foreign Correspondents Club of South Asia. And in course of the year, we are also planning to have a huge summit of top editors of newspapers, TV channels, and magazines from all over the world to talk about state of the media, state of the freedom in the world's largest democracy and also the world. I want to thank you all for coming to attend this function. And so keep watching our website and keep receiving our emails to find out what we are up to. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. You know, as some of you who are members here and visit regularly, you've seen that this club has gone through a massive overhaul. And one of the beautiful additions to the club, sir, is the room that we are sitting in today. And this auditorium was only commissioned about 6 months ago, 9 months ago. And we are very proud that we are hosting great events such as the one here now. May I please request the cell phones to be turned off completely? Now I would request my colleague, Mr. Jeffrey Gettleman. He's the Vice President of the club and from the New York Times, a celebrity amongst us, may I say, to please address us. Yeah.
Thank you. I am the South Asia Bureau Chief for the New York Times, and let me begin by saying what an honor it is to be sitting here next to you in this club, in this country. Foreign correspondent, being a foreign correspondent is almost a dying art, a dying craft. When I started in my career 20 years ago, everybody in journalism wanted to be a foreign correspondent. And there were people all around the world from American, it's not working. There were so many foreign correspondents covering the world, from mid-sized newspapers like the Chicago Tribune, the LA Times, the Boston Globe, the Baltimore Sun. And when I was starting out 20 years ago, that was the destination, the dream for so many of us, was to be overseas. Today, we need this more than ever. We are living in a world that is more confused, more interconnected, and where news is more challenged than it's ever been. What is news? The advent of fake news, the accusations against people in the media, where we've never felt so many different pressures, how to tell stories, how to use mobile phones, or even, God forbid, a notebook and a pen. And there's very few organizations that still follow this old model of sending somebody, not just to be a tourist, to pass through a country, but to live there, to try to understand it, its culture, its people, its language. And I'm very lucky to have that, because so many, all those newspapers I named, the Baltimore Sun, Chicago Tribune, the LA Times, they have nobody left. There's just a handful of foreign correspondents that whose organizations believe there's a value in taking somebody and their family. My wife is sitting here in the front row. And our two kids, and helping them get settled in a foreign land so they can transmit what's happening in the best way. And I just worry that there's, you know, so many people are just scanning through their phones. You know, they don't care where they're getting their news. They don't want the thoroughness and the depth and the richness that we've been trained to do. And I spent some time in on the border of Bangladesh and Myanmar recently, writing about the Rohingya crisis. It was probably, since I moved here, the most impactful journalism I've done. No offense to India. But this was a big humanitarian crisis, and I'd come from East Africa, where we had been living for a decade, and I was used to these big humanitarian stories. And there were very few other journalists out there. I mean, people are phoning it in. You know, you're seeing posts on Facebook or Yahoo or, you know, some of the wire services that don't take the time and the investment to send people to stand in these camps and to look people in the face and try to tell their stories so other people care. And I like to say that in journalism, we're in the empathy generation business. If we're doing our jobs right, we should be generating empathy. We should be making people care. And as a foreign correspondent, that lesson is there's no more important aspect of foreign correspondence than doing that. Because I write for the New York Times. There's educated people, there are Indians, there are people who've worked in South Asia, but there's many, many people who haven't. And for them to pick up the newspaper and care what happened this past week with riots across northern India, you have to explain these things in clear terms, but with some passion and some energy. So I just feel like this club kind of represents the best of that spirit. And the fact you've been doing it, you know, for so long, and I'm envious of how these older guys worked, because their bosses weren't sending them an email every 5 minutes to jump on this or jump on that. They could disappear for weeks. And phone in, you know, 2 weeks later and say, hey, I got this story, here it is, bye. And we still have a little of that. Like, when we're doing our jobs well, we're still tasting a little of that adventure. So I'm just grateful that there's a place that gathers and supports people who are practicing this. And I really appreciate your support for joining us tonight to help us celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeffrey, and I hope you keep coming back to the club and share some more of your experiences, particularly the ones from East Africa. I'm sure people would love it, especially the young budding journalists. And moving on, may I now request Mr. Francois Guattier, Managing Committee member of the club and a long-standing member of the club, to please share his remarks.
Thank you. Thanks very much. So what Jeffrey said is so true. You know, India is such an interesting country, such a vast country, so diverse. You know, for a journalist, it's a dream. It's a dream to report, whatever your opinions and whatever side you come from. It's a dream to be a journalist in India, a foreign journalist. And when I started being a journalist in the mid-80s and in the 90s, there were so many of us, full-time correspondent. Every newspaper had a full-time correspondent, sometimes, you know, with a deputy, sometimes three. And today we see that, no offense, you know, but countries like my country, France, Le Figaro, the paper for which I work, they have stringers, you know. So in those days when I started, we used telex. We were still the telex. You know, to send a story by telex, you have no idea what it means for a journalist, you know. No, in French, so once I interviewed Rajiv Gandhi in English, translated in French, and I had to send it by telex to my newspaper in Paris, in French, and it all came garbled in Paris. You know? So when the email came in the 90s, you know, that was a revolution, you know, for us journalists, you know, to send an email without mistake, because there was a fax also. You know? Used to send fax, 5 pages of fax, you know, one page would not go through, you had to resend the whole thing again. From India, you know, in those days in India. Although it was not, the lines were not so good. So email was a revolution. And of course, we spent a lot of time here in the FCC, all of us. You know, there was no internet. There was not much TV in India yet. So, you know, there was more social interaction. Used to come with my wife, Namrita, here. We had so many good friends. There was Nick Robertson, of the photographer for the Time magazine. There was Tim of the Guardian. There was Bruno Philippe of the Monde. There was so many of us, you know, and we were a good crowd, and we enjoyed each other's presence here. And then we used to go to Srinagar. Those days, Srinagar was a hot place to be. There was only one hotel open in Srinagar. It was called, I think, Adu's, right?
Yeah, it's still there.
Still there, Adu's, on, you know, on the Jhelum Bank, you know. And there was curfew all the time. So again, we spent a lot of time together. So these were good times, huh? These were good times. Before everybody was on the phone and on the internet. These were nice times, yeah. So I am a lover of India, and I'm a defender of your country, sir, because I think it's a wonderful country. You know, there is so much diversity, so much greatness here. So I do hope that China, which always, you know, hogs the limelight, you know, India will start hogging the limelight for the good reasons, because it's a democratic country, it's a liberal country. There are so great people here. So much warmth, hospitality. So we're grateful to the FCC because we spent a lot of time here. Grateful to Venkat and Munish for, you know, propping it up again. And we hope that more and more foreign journalists will come to India, you know, and report on this wonderful country. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Francois. But I can assure you that India is hogging the headlines everywhere today. And I'm sure that Jeffrey would vouch for that. Our other friends would vouch for that. It's been a long journey for the Foreign Correspondents Club over the last few years, where we nearly came to a standstill, and then we had to decide to bring it up back to where it is today. And you know, this means special joy for all of you, you know, present here, and some of us who are traveling today, not here today. And I still remember that Venkat and I and some of us met Sir Mark Tully, was it Venkat, almost a year and a half ago in an emergency meeting, and said, look, we can't let this club shut down. It represents what Jeffrey exactly said, you know, the spirit of journalists and journalism. And it's, you know, you get certain beautiful vibes as you walk into this place, and especially when you're hanging out with the people of your own, you know, community. And I think we need to work on it a little more. I would request all of you to pitch in whatever way you can. Even if you're public affairs of an embassy, please visit us more often. And now, before I request His Excellency to give his special remarks, may I request my two colleagues from the Managing Committee, Hugh Tomlinson from The Times, and PM Narayan from ADR German Radio and Television, to please come here and request His Excellency to unveil the special logo that we have created for the 60th year celebrations of the Foreign Correspondents Club. It's a very special logo, sir, and a memento that we would like you to unveil. Please come up. Let's all stand up and be with them. Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency. As you can see from the vibrance of the colors of the logo, you know, this club has become more vibrant than before. And with your support, with your guidance, and with the continued interaction, I'm sure that the vibrancy would only get better. May I now take this special privilege and honor to request His Excellency, the Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu, to please deliver his special remarks.
Sri Venkatnan Garu, my good old friend, I don't know what his age, he was a journalist from my student days. Now I have become Vice President, I don't know what is his age. I have been seeing him, meeting him, watching him, reading his articles. Gentleman of the finest core in a more professional manner, while he didn't get any, what do you call, that stink of any kind, whatever that is associated with either with politicians or with the journalists or other professions. So I am happy to be all here with you all. I'm having a problem because since last 2 days, I've been suffering with the running nose and headache, and the doctors told me that infection has gone inside. So they advised me not to travel, not to speak. So contrary to their advice, morning I went to Himachal Pradesh, Hamirpur, Jalandhar, up to Jalandhar by flight, by helicopter to Hamirpur, and then by road to attend a World International Science Youth Congress. Name is Youth Congress, but not actually the, the political one. This is sponsored by Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. That has really aggravated the problem. After that, also I thought I can take rest for a while, but there was another appointment where I has to host the Nepalese Prime Minister at my residence. That took considerable time. So then I came here. So there is some sort of discomfort, not with the club, with my thing. So Mr. Jeffrey Gatelman, Vice President of the club, and also Francis Gauthier, Sri Manish Gupta, and brothers and sisters who are part of this club. First of all, I would like to convey my best wishes, compliments and congratulations to all of you on the occasion of the 60th year of the Foreign Correspondents Club of South Asia. I am told this organization was established in 1958 by a handful of foreign correspondents, and I am told it has grown up, and then there are more than 800 plus journalists. That's a remarkable progress of the club. Friends, the India is one of the oldest multicultural, multi-religious, multilinguistic societies with a rich tradition of accepting, assimilating every culture and custom. We have some thousands of years of civilization. The Babylonian civilization, Roman civilization, or the Egypt civilization, or the Greek civilization and all. If you compare, Indian civilization is still dynamic, vibrant. The reason is we believe in the principle of Vasudhaika Kutumbam. The entire universe is one. That is the basic philosophy of this country. Second is we also believe in Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu. That means that all people live in happiness and prosperity. These are the two foundations of the Indian philosophy. India's GDP was 27% of the world GDP earlier. And civilization, as I told you, is very old. We have students who have come from different parts of the globe, studied here in the Nalanda University and the earlier Takshashila universities. Huan Song, Pahiyan, the great Chinese historians, they came and wrote about India. And we had trade those days itself with so many other countries. But please note that India has no history of attacking any country, not committed any aggression against anybody. Everybody else came on India, ruled us, ruined us, cheated us also. It may be a little unpalatable to some people, and my people were telling me, sir, now you are vice president. I said, facts are facts. So what, even if I have become vice president? The colonial rule has affected us by many ways. But still, India is now once again on the move. I think and I hope, I'm confident that going by the present situation, India is moving ahead, and thanks to the leadership, we have stability and also ability. If you have stability and ability, then you can have prosperity. Of course, we are often disturbed by one of our neighbors who is aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorism. It's an open fact. Some people are ready to acknowledge it, some people do not, for a variety of reasons, including political reasons and also diplomatic reasons. The fact of the matter is open to see for anybody that this terrorism is being openly encouraged. I'm sorry to say the West earlier did not acknowledge this. Now, as they have become victims, now everybody, the Europeans or the Americans, everybody is acknowledging the fact that terrorism is a big threat. According to us, terrorism is the enemy of humanity. Terror has no religion. But please note, some people are trying to take shelter under religion. That's how this conflict is coming. No religion, whether it is Hindu or Christianity or Islam, to my knowledge, to my understanding, to the best of the knowledge of many of us, preaches or accepts terror. You can go through any of these books. Nowhere it supported terror. But terrorism on using the religion cover. That's one important thing that has to be noted by everybody. And here in India, as I told you, we have different ways of life, different languages, different dialects, different dress, different ways of living also. But still, the country is united. That's the beauty of this country. We also say, Vividhata mein ekata Bharat ka visheshata, that in this diversity, there is unity. Alag bhasha, alag vesh, phir bhi apna ek desh. There are different languages and people proud of their language. And I also feel that they should really feel proud of their language. Everybody should learn and practice their mother tongue and learn other languages. That's my conviction as a citizen of this country. But at the same time, we must also respect other languages, other regions, other religions and all. And that's what is happening. There are some aberrations, some incidents here and there in a vast country like 130 crores. But unfortunately, those are highlighted instead of isolating them, identifying them, acting firmly against them. People, political parties, for their own reasons, they try to, some of them are glorified, some try to glorify them also. That's why the problem of impression and image is getting affected. What I am trying to say is that each one of you, the foreign correspondents, you have a onerous task on your hands. Before covering developments or any events in the country, my advice to anybody is that you must understand the country. You must go around the country. You must see and understand and then appreciate what is happening, rather than being carried away by statement of some party or some person or by some hearsay, or by some sort of a projection by some people. We have different political parties in this country with different ideologies. And that is the beauty of Indian system. But at the same time, political parties, they try to win over people by good things. Sometimes they try to lead and mislead people also. It's because of political reasons and all, they try to give different colors and all. But unless you reach out to the people, understand them, you will not be able to appreciate the complexity of India. I can tell you my own example. I come from an ordinary agriculture background. I started my career as one of the youngsters pasting wall poster on the wall, a student, then making announcement about the visit of our leader, great leader, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, to my town. None of them, my family members, were in politics. I have no dynasty to boast. Of course, I feel dynasty is nasty in politics. But it's tasty to some people. That weakness is there in our system. Not only our system, even otherwise also. And how I became the Vice President of India. Before that, I was minister in Modi's government. And before that, I was minister in Vajpayee's government. Earlier, I was minister for rural development. Like any other people, now people, there is no, people are migrating from rural to urban. I migrated to urban development from rural development. And then in between, I was the president of the ruling party at a young age, a ruling party, which people used to call as North Indian Party and all. All names have been given. I am not here to defend now because I am nowhere in politics. I have resigned from politics, but not tired from public life. That's why I am active and I am going around. The journey is successful because I visited 620 districts of the country, met different sections of the people, and then I've been regularly touring also. Some people may complain now, even after becoming vice president also, sir, you are touring and all. Within another 10 days, I'll be completing one round of the entire country as vice president. Why I'm saying this with all confidence is because I have seen the country. I have understood the country. And I get first-hand information. That's why I can speak with authority. From a distance, it's very easy to make comments. We saw the outgoing American president came here and gave some advice. Good. America is a friend. But immediately, within few days, he has to look back what is happening in his own country. You understand whom I am mentioning. So these are problems, but these problems has to be understood, their genesis has to be understood, their background has to be understood, the circumstance has to be understood before we project any country. If it is a routine thing locally, because there is action, there is reaction, there is some effect and side effect, and then there is some clarification and all. But when you are sending stories to foreign countries, other countries, you must be sure about the reality of the matter. Because information, in this age of information, is moving very fast, reaching very fast. And now it has become a headline. It also became habit for some people. They just see the headlines. When I was party general secretary, my friends from the media used to say, sir, this has happened, what is your reaction? I said, wow, it has not happened. No, sir, this is the headline. I said, your headline is not going to be my deadline. I have my own line. I know what is happening. With confidence, I used to say, because I have my own channels of communication and all. And media has got its own way of trying to find out information and all. What I have to say, my first observation is, because I am here in the club, information with confirmation is more than an emanation. Information without confirmation, it cannot be a real emanation. So we have to really work hard, and we have to be well acquainted with the country where we are working. Not only well acquainted with the facts, with also the background, the social composition, and also the political situation of this country. Truth and objectivity has to be the touchstones. Otherwise, if you are in haste or if you are led by the general trend of sensationalism, then truth will become a casualty. And after that, people will become a casualty. That's my second observation. See, the lot of people come to me in India. Earlier as a minister, I was Minister for Information and Broadcasting also for some time. They come to me, sir, we are starting a new channel, we are starting a new newspaper, and please give your blessings or your bite and all. I always tell them, simple in my own way, I said, be nearer to truth, away from sensationalism. Because you are doing irreparable damage to the country and to the society, to create dissensions within the society and also creating apprehension in the minds of the people. And then things happen. Subsequently, even if you find that what has been reported is wrong, there's no way you can remedy it by the time the reaction. Because I feel caste, religion, region, water, language, they catch up with the people very easily. And you have tensions and all. After some time, it loses its relevance after people realize ye to hone wala nahi hai. But that's being used. So that's one of the weaknesses of our system. That's why I always tell everybody, with my own experience, to youngsters particularly, now I have taken a mission to visit all the universities, IITs, research institutes across the country as part of the vice president's responsibility. I am telling all these youngsters, let everyone try to first understand and then try to form opinions and then start questioning also. Questioning is part of democracy. If there is no questioning, then you won't get proper answers. So definitely the media should question, media should stand up, media also should really stand up and then say, yes, this is the truth, I stand by it. Then the system will function very effectively and it will be more useful to the society. If the system fails, media not standing to the truth or subordinating itself before the might of the government, you know what has happened. We have an aberration again of emergency. I am also a product of that emergency. My mother wanted me to become a lawyer. I studied law and about to practice. Meanwhile, emergency came. They put me in jail because I invited Jay Prakash Narayan to the university. On that ground, they put me in MISA for 17 and a half months. So that has changed my course of life, and then I came to public life. I don't know whether I have to thank the rulers at the time or... But that was a situation where the media, except a few people like Ramnath Goenka, like C.R. Irani, like Nikhil Chakravarti, like our Kuldeep Nayyar, the most important person, they stood against the emergency. And then they have filed stories because they are convinced what is happening is wrong. That sort of courage and conviction should be there for everybody. If you want to have that courage and conviction, you must first of all have clarity on the reality. Not knowing reality, or with being influenced by the ideologies, there are different ideologies in our country also. Some are local, some are foreign, some are imported, some are supported, some are outdated. A lot of ideologies are there. But if your vision is colored by that, and then you become a journalist. Journalist is a profession. It is a mission, not for commission. And there should not be any omission. Our truth cannot be any remission, according to me. That's my conviction. If you do it that way, then you are doing justice to yourself and justice to the mankind. That's why wherever I go, I'm telling these things. I was just telling you earlier. I say, let everyone have character, caliber, capacity and conduct. But unfortunately, in systems across the globe, also in Europe, in India, these are four C's, I say: character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. Some people are trying to replace it by three C's, or four C's, whatever it is caste, community, cash, criminality. That's also creates problems to the system. In India, both things are operational. There are people with character, caliber, capacity, and conduct in public life. There are people who are trying to use the shortcut methods of raising emotions and commotions in the society. So you have to understand this, and then it becomes fashion for somebody to, if they are really exposing the cousin of a region, you can understand even that they are not doing it. And they are not doing any favor of that particular religion or whatever it is, if they have some faith in that. They are just trying to use it. That is one scenario one has to understand. Friends, the contextualization becomes all the more important when a journalist from a developed nation is reporting on the affairs of a developing country. Your text will be richer if you can get the context right. This is the point I want to make. The other point. We can't compare ourselves with all those countries which are otherwise well developed also. But for instance, the strides made by India's space program is something spectacular. Given the constraints of resources and technology when compared to a developed nation, India sent a rover to Mars at almost 1/9 of the cost of a similar mission of an advanced nation. Though it received coverage, why I'm mentioning this abroad, a repeated foreign daily published a cartoon lampooning the success it had to finally apologize after readers expressed their outrage at the cartoon. So in journalism, I feel the readers also have a say. They can also influence. Another problem that has come up is, as I was mentioning about ideological people, ideology-oriented people and all, the problem is that the moment you combine this and that together, that becomes news and views. Mixing of news and views is no good. This is what I have been trying to impress upon the people. Views, yes, you must have views. But views should be relegated to editorial page or separate, in the form of a separate article. But news and views should be separate. This is my feeling. And this is what I want to impress upon everybody. The terrorist problem. Reporting about the terrorist violence. A terrorist is terrorist irrespective of whether he kills innocents in Kashmir or in Kentucky. This is where I feel that justice is not being done to the cause. Surprisingly, some media organizations describe those indulging in terrorism in Kashmir as separatists and militants. And any similar incident in the West is immediately dubbed as a terror attack and the perpetrators as terrorists. Why? If somebody attacks you, then they are terrorists. If somebody attacks here, no, they have. Everybody will take some excuse. They'll say, I have done it because I am against this, I am against that and all. But the democracy, that's why the civilization is developed in such a way to have democracy. Democracy. In democracy, if you are unhappy with a system or with a ruler or with a party or with a rule, create opinion and then fight against that and remove and defeat it in the election. And India has shown the way. Even the strongest so-called great leaders were defeated by the ballot. That's why this philosophy of supporting terror, supporting gun and all is never going to succeed. I always tell people that ballot is more powerful than bullet. That has been proved beyond doubt in India. So if you believe what you are saying is right and what you think is right, go to the people, educate them.
rather than trying to take to terrorism and then trying to take the support of others and trying to vitiate the atmosphere and create innocent, kill innocent people. This is where I feel that people who are watching it from a distance, they must understand. You might say good news is no news, but it cannot be bad news all the time either. When I was in BJP, I used to ask our friends, Babu, small incident has happened and you have made it a big headline in BJP, but in the other party, fighting is going on, attack on office and all. Yeah, they said, yes, sir. And he said, told me, Mr. Naidu, if a man bites a dog, it's a news. If dog bites a man, it's normal. So you BJP fellows have said that you are a party with a difference. That's why any small thing happening, it becomes news. And he is right. I realized also, the fault do not lie with him, because the fault lies with the party, with my former party, which said that we are a party with a difference. So any small thing happening in BJP, naturally it gets importance. But the dimension has to be understood to what extent. It was, whatever it has happened, who has done it, etc. That also has to be noted. Friends, the another aspect that I want to impress upon is Venkatananji, is the news should be positive. Positive means not positive for a particular party or for a particular viewpoint. It should develop positivity in the minds of the people rather than negativity. This is where I feel that every one of us has to focus. And then after so much civilizational movement forward, we should all focus in on development. Every political party, every system, every media organization must have the agenda is development, coupled with welfare of the people, and then uplifting the poor. Because this rich and poor, this difference which is going up and growing, is no good for the world order. We have to see that economic disparities are brought down. For that is, one way is to create wealth. There is another problem dimension. Everybody starts saying, distribute wealth. To distribute wealth, first you have to create wealth. Na? Without creating wealth, if you distribute wealth, you will become pauper. This is what has happened to many states and many countries also. So the people should be motivated, and the rulers also should be engaged in the discussion on development and creation of wealth. What means socialism means, or communism means, or capitalism or other things and all, it is left to them, this thing. But the driving should be, the focus should be according, it's only advice. It's not binding on you because the Vice President of India is saying something and all. I feel as a citizen, I feel the focus should be more on positivity, more on engaging people on positive sides and developmental stories of a different kind happening in different parts of the group, how they have done it, how they have developed it. That sort of a thing will really enthuse the people who are doing something good to do many more things better for the system. This is what I want to suggest. Then some incidents of stray incidents here and there, communal incidents there, these are aberrations. But to say that there is strife in the society and all, you have seen recently, I think Mr. Jeffrey Edelman also was referring to that in a different this thing. Supreme Court has given a judgment. Nobody read the judgment. There was some reaction. There were some apprehensions. And then the government of the day, they tried to address them. And then later, the full details have come. In between, some incidents happened. But they should be viewed in the context of, as I told you, the conflict of a political nature on one side, the means that are adopted, the violence or the violent methods, they are no solution, they are not going to solve any problems also. You have to really project it in such a way, this has not done anything good to the people. But unfortunately, what is happening outside, inside, even the legislatures and outside also, constructivity is not getting enough attention. Even in our Indian media also. I came to Parliament some 20 years back with the fond hope of making a mark here, having made a mark in legislature in my province. And my agriculture is my passion. So I, as an opposition member, prepared very well one day and came to Parliament. I was given an opportunity. I spoke for 52 minutes on agriculture, various dimensions, challenges, how agriculture has become now slowly unviable and all. Everyone, right from the ruling party to opposition party to Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, who was sitting in the House, he was a member at the time, to Sharad Pawar, supposed to be farmers leader, to different political parties, they all came to me and complimented Mr. Naidu. Very, very well thought of speech. They congratulated. Next day, no newspaper covered it. Except one newspaper said Mr. Naidu spoke elaborately on agriculture and its allied problem. Yes, that's all. So what is the incentivity? What are you giving to the people? How are you motivating? So that's why the people are saying, sir, isme kya hai? Something constructive. I am saying constructive also will become a news. The new generation worldwide, and particularly in India, where 65% of the population is below 35 years, is now aspirational India. Aspirational world, even otherwise, wherever I am interacting with other countries, just now I had a discussion with the Nepalese Prime Minister. He was saying, sir, now the thinking is different, it's aspirational. Every section, every segment, every community, every sub-community, they all want that they should become part of the development. They want to become part of the growth story. This is the reality. This is what even the present Prime Minister also is talking about, inclusive growth and then fruits of development reaching everybody and all. So this positive report are highlighting positivity, constructivity will definitely help the world order. This is what I feel. Because without peace, progress is not possible. If you have tension on the border, you cannot have attention inside. So this, coupled with that, some constructive approach and appreciating something good and reporting and supporting something positive that has happened, we is going to definitely help the humanity. I am talking of the international context, not in one context alone. And coming back to friends, today India, according to me, has become unstoppable. I'm not saying because I was there with this ruling party till the other day and all. Because you have seen, in spite of world global slowdown, India could withstand all this and making positive progress. And in spite of the Prime Minister's passion for reforms, he gave a three-line advice. Much of you might have been familiar. He said reform, perform, and transform. He want to bring a transformation every walk of life. And there is some resistance here and there. There is widespread welcome of the same. So with all this demonetization, with the GST, with this Binami transaction, so many things which is in a hurry. People say he's in a hurry to do. With all this, still 6.4, 7 point dot percentage, World Bank, World Economic Forum, ADB, Moody ratings, not Modi, Moody ratings. Everyone is confirming that India is on the growth path. And I can tell you, in Sherry, any reform, there will be some problems. That's why when I was a minister, I used to say temporary pain for long-term gain. Temporary pain for long-term gain. And some, in certain cases, for example, one is attacked with cancer, you need to be given chemotherapy. The patient normally will be hesitating, sir. He will be saying, sir, I am told if chemotherapy is given, there will be hair fall and all. So doctor used to tell him, if you don't go for chemotherapy, you will fall. If you use for chemotherapy, it will be only hair fall. Otherwise, you will fall, choice is yours. Similarly, the black money, the counterfeit currency by our neighbor, and also a lot of other weaknesses that have come, people felt that it was necessary. What happened to that, and I'm not getting into that, political parties are discussing, let them discuss, I have no problem. Some people are saying, sir, the entire money has come back to banks. What is the fun of this? As a citizen, my simple understanding is, the very purpose of demonetization was to see that the entire money comes to banks. The money which was laying in bedroom, bathroom, under the pillow, that has to come back to bank. It has come to bank. How much is white, how much is black, how much is official, how much is non-official, the Reserve Bank has a duty to make it very clear at the earliest. But money coming back to bank, and then some people say, sir, what? They are, the direct result, friends, see, the interest rate has come down. Banks are flooded with money. Interest rates have come down from 12% to 10%, from 9.5% or like that. That's the biggest advantage people have got. And then the GST. GST also is a very radical, revolutionary, transformational taxation proposal. This thing. But it had resistance. It had implementation. There were some problems. There might have been some lapses also. It have been done in a better manner. One can have that opinion. Nothing wrong and all. But the end of it, you will see, you have, I think some of you might have realized also, what are going to be the positive effects. People who are familiar with the economy, they are all seeing the increase in the revenue. The increase in the revenue. Even on the job front also, see the today's or yesterday's Financial Express. How things are moving and all. So these are all problems, but I am sure with these reforms, and broadly there is a broad acceptance of reforms. Political parties' posturing may differ. No, you know, when that party started introducing GST, this party opposed it. And this party introduced it, that party initially opposed it. And finally, they all came together and with a consensus, the reforms have been implemented. Reforms have come on to stay. And they will move forward. That's my confidence as a citizen of this country and also as a person who has got some knowledge of Indian political system. So with the reforms, the country's future is bright. And the last point I want to say is, Indian people has got an inherent knowledge. I'm not trying to boast my country. Of course, there's nothing wrong as a countryman if I speak good about my country also. Inherent, the talent, the taddy tapper, the weaver, the fisherman, the goldsmith, the blacksmith, the washerman. You touch any person, the talent. Because why this talent? Because of thousands of years of civilization and the knowledge that the forefathers has given to us and the experience of their living, which these people got. That's why you go to United States, go to Silicon Valley, you find every alternative person from India. You have a lot of Indians now heading multinational companies abroad, including in America. It is Nadella Satya, or Indira Nui, or Sundar Pichai, or Sagurthi Purna for, I think, with that word, Narisetti. He was the editor for Washington.
Raju
Narisetti. Washington Post, no, he was for some time.
Yes.
Because the talent is there. And only thing is that you have to give opportunity for the talent and then allow them to move. That's what is happening. That's why I feel India has a bright future. And these operations also, slowly people are trying to understand the designs of such people who are trying to create this thing and all. And before I conclude, there is often some confusion in the minds of the people about what is this Hindu business. Hindu, I'm not talking about the Hindu newspaper. Hindu newspaper is not for Hindus. Understand, no? It's for all. Hindustan Times newspaper is there. It's for all. Though name is Hindustan. Hindi Akbar bhi hai. For all. Then you have so many, I can give you a list of nearly 500 companies whose name is Hindu. Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, HAL. Hindustan Shipyard Limited, Hindustan Zinc Limited, like that, Hindustan Copper, so many antibiotics, it's all. Because the identity, The identity of this nation was Sindhu, Hindu, Indus, all it came like that. This is not given by Narendra Modi or Venkaiah Naidu or Atal Bihari Vajpayee or anybody. This is one. You go to Pakistan from India, they will ask you, Kaisaji, theek hai na? Kab aaya Hindustan se? No, 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 main Hindustan se nahi aaya hu. I don't like that word. You won't say it, na? The other day, Iran leader has come. He was talking, oh, Kare, Hindustan. That is a context one has to understand. Hindu is partly a religion for some people, but it's a way of life to many of the people. That's why this confusion comes and all. Religion is a way of worship. Culture is a way of life. People like me and many people in this country, we feel that this is the cultural identity of the nation. Cultural identity of the nation. So that's why this dilemma, sometimes confusion and all, and some people go to other extreme and give slogans also to provoke people or mislead people and all. But that's not the core of a Hindu philosophy or Indian philosophy or whatever it is. People say, sir, why you call it as Hindu? Why don't you call it as India? Why don't you call it as something else? I said, why don't you call it as Hindu also? Why otherwise? Why not otherwise? If somebody is giving a new name, then you must have some problem. It is there, na? It is also there as part. And some people say secularism, some people also say secularism, and some political parties also argue here in India, it's because of us, secularism is there. And some people say secularism is being protected by us and all. I want to tell everybody very frankly, I have the weakness and strength of speaking frankly. Secularism is safe, not because of political parties, not because of any leader, not because of even constitution also. Secularism is safe in India because it is in the very DNA of every Indian. There may be few exceptions. There may be few exceptions, always you know, there will be some extreme fellows who will be giving wrong interpretation and all. That's the core. Subsequently, it has been, many people may not be knowing, originally secularism was not there in the constitution. Subsequently, it has come. Do you mean to say those days secularism was not there in India? It was, it is, it will be. It will be because we live. That's why initially I made that remark that India has no history of attacking anybody. We want to live in harmony. And in India, people love and respect even pakshi, birds. We have festival for birds. We have festival for animals. In South, Sankranti, there's a one day festival of animals. And we have the system, my grandfather used to send me during holidays to do agriculture. He said anybody who is a son of a farmer must go and work in the field during holidays. We used to think, anyway, we want to enjoy and what this old man is telling us, go and work in the field. So we used to go because there's no way. You can't defy your grandfather those days. This maize and jowar and other crops, when they grow, the birds used to come and then eat them and then disturb the crop. So my grandfather used to create a mancha, what do you call a platform with this thing, with all these bamboos and all. And we used to climb up to the platform and then used to have a jute thing in our hand with a stone in that and then used to move it like that to threaten those birds. And they used to run away after all this. Subsequently, the interesting thing is here. After a month or so, when the crop is harvested, same grandfather used to say, some of these crops, you have to hang it in front of your house. After you cut it, what do you call that? Kankul Nevantama?
Maize.
Maize is okay, but that branch, last branch. Yes. And it becomes fruit or it has become ripe. I don't have an appropriate word in English. I have not studied in English medium also. As I told you, I am a rural fellow. So, and we used to hang all those things. And these birds used to come and then eat them. I asked my grandfather, earlier you said to drive away the birds? Now you are saying, allow the birds and they are coming every day and then eating something. He said, Babu, they should also survive, na? We should feed them also. I said, you earlier told me, drive them away. He said, that's a bird. It do not know the crop is not ripe. It will disturb the crop, disturb your crop. That's why at that time, before it becomes ripe or mature, you have to drive them away. Once they are matured, you are happy, your crop has come back to your home, you be happy and make the birds also happy by offering this. That's the basic core philosophy of this country. Even today, you go to villages, people will tell you the same thing. But here, there are, as I told you, different ideologies who believe that people cannot live together. There are some aberrations, there are some social evils here and there. They have been identified, and the new generation is ready to fight against those social evils. We have come out of the age of so many things from dowry. Now, dowry is becoming now almost out of fashion also. Now, intercaste marriages are also increasing, and also common activity everywhere. Everybody can go, nobody is going to ask you to which community you belong or which religion you belong to and all. But we should try to see that we create such a positive atmosphere to strengthen the social cohesion further. That's the point I made. Friends, because you have invited me to come to your 60 years function, I thought I should share some of my thoughts, ideas with you people in my own way. I try to put forth my point of view and also point of view of the country before you. Other things, and wherever there are shortcomings, the leadership of the country and the people of the country, including journalists, all of us, we will have to take note of them and apply correctives also. I would like to thank Sri Venkatananji, Manish ji, and Francis Gautier and other friends for giving me this opportunity. I would like to thank you all. Earlier, I could have done something to this club, but now I can't do anything because I am Vice President. Vice President Mr. Venkatanarayan came to me and earlier requested me to do something and all. I said, at that time I was Minister, I said, okay. Because the foreign correspondents also are very important to report to the world community, also to project the proper image and facts rather than knowing from a distance and then learning it from hearsay. Better they are here and they meet regularly, interact with our Indian other journalists also. That is going to really help. That's why I told them, I told my colleague also, even when I was leaving the ministry, I told the minister, you have to regularize it or give it on a long lease. Whatever I could do little, I will try to do it in future. Don't worry on that account also. Thank you very much.
We thank you, Your Excellency, for such...
I have one request to all of you. Whenever you meet me or greet me, don't call me Excellency.
Okay.
Either I am excellent or not will be known after my demise. So, Honorable Vice President of India.
Okay.
Because I told them also, I made a point in the Parliament itself, I made this statement. I don't want to be called as Excellency, number one. Number two, also people said, so they asked me, sir, you have now become Vice President. What about the dress? Because normally dress means President, Vice President means Bandhgala. But I said, no change of dress, only change of address. Earlier I was in Abdul Kalam Road, now I have moved to Maulana Azad Road. That's all. And even I have removed in the Rajya Sabha, when you send correspondence also, or have to place something on the floor of the table, ministers used to raise and say, sir, chairman, sir, I beg to lay. I said, no begging here afterwards. We are independent India. I raise to lay on the table of the house. I raise to place. These are small changes we are trying to bring in our system. So please bear with me.
Well, thank you very much, Honorable Vice President of India. And we were just delighted to hear, and I was particularly delighted to hear some of the stories and experiences and anecdotes that you've shared with us, and I'm sure the audience here and my colleagues have enjoyed the same. I agree with you completely where you talked about secularism is in the DNA of every Indian. Because, sir, as I have traveled the world and lived overseas for 32, 33 years now, I have come across many, many Indians who have lived overseas now for hundreds of years. And if it wasn't for this, they couldn't have adapted those foreign lands and become a part of them. So we are very much a part of a new culture. We thank you again for taking this opportunity to come here, to share your thoughts, to always have supported the Foreign Correspondents Club of India. And we'll continue to always benefit with your wisdom and your generosity. Thank you very much. Let's rise again for the national anthem, please.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jayahe Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindhu Gujarat Maratha Dravid Utkal Banga Vindhya Himachal Yamuna Ganga Uchhal Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Yashish Mange Gahe Tab Jaya Gatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayak Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He Jaya He